and I want to welcome you out to the Omega Church this morning. Once again, we're going to have our special Christmas program. I don't know, I think Lauren and I and Katie have been here now for probably 13 years. Katie's 14, so we've been here now for 13 years. And what a blessing it's been. One of the things that has blessed my life, and I know everybody else's, is every year when we get together, we do this Christmas service, this Christmas program, and it's one of the most wonderful things that it just really adds to my Christmas season, and I'm looking forward to that today. And so with that being said, we are going to have our special Christmas service.
One of the things that I dearly love about Christmas,
both growing up and here at the Omega Church is that the Lord blessed my family with a lot of talent, and the Lord has blessed the Omega Church with a lot of talent. And I can remember being a youngster at home, sitting around our living room at Christmas time, and we would all play some sort of an instrument, sing some sort of a song. So today, in that honor and in that tradition, we're going to have some people who are going to be singing and playing some instruments. And the first one is Katie, so we're going to ask Katie to come. She's going to play a song for us on her saxophone, and then she'll be up a little bit later after Michaela and Rachel sing their duets.
We've already done the chores, and I couldn't think of a single thing that needed doing, especially not on a night like this. But I knew Pa was not a very patient one, dragging one's feet when he told them to do something. So I got up, put my boots back on, got my cap and coat, and then Mom gave a mysterious smile as I opened the door to leave the house. Something was up, but I didn't know what. Outside, I became even more dismayed. There in front of the house was the work team, already hitched up to the big sled. Whatever it was we were going to do wasn't going to be quick and short. No little job, I could tell that. We never hitched up the sled unless we were going to haul a big load. Pa was already on the seat, reins in hand, and I reluctantly climbed up beside him. The cold was already biting at me. I wasn't happy. When I was on, Pa pulled the sled around the house and stopped in front of the woodshed. He got off and I followed. I think we'll put on the high side boards, he said. Here, help me. The high side boards. It had been a bigger job than I wanted to do with just the low side boards on. But whatever it was we were going to do would be a lot bigger with the high side boards on. After we exchanged the side boards, Pa went into the woodshed and came out with an armload of wood. The wood I spent all summer hauling down from the mountain and all fall sawing into blocks and splitting. "What was he doing?" Finally, I said something. "Pa," I asked, "what are you doing?" I said, "You been by the Widow Jensen's house lately?" He asked. The Widow Jensen lived about 2 miles down the road. Her husband had died a year or so before and left her with 3 small children, the oldest being 8. "Sure, I've been, but so what?" "Yeah," I said, "why?" "I rode by just today," Pa said. "Little Jakey was out digging around the woodpile trying to find a few chips. They're out of wood, Matt." That was all he said, and then he turned and went back into the woodshed for another armload of wood. I followed him. We loaded the sled so high that I began to wonder if the horse would be able to pull it. Finally, Pa called a halt to loading. Then he went into the smokehouse, and Pa took out a big ham and a side of bacon. He handed them to me and told them to put them in the sled and wait. When we returned, he was carrying a sack of flour over his right shoulder and a smaller bag with something in his left hand. "What's in the sack?" I asked. "Shoes, a lot of shoes. Little Jamie had gunny sacks wrapped around his feet when he was out in the wood pile this morning. I got the children a little candy too. It just wouldn't be Christmas without a little candy." We rode the 2 miles to the Widow Jensen's pretty much in silence. I tried to think through what Pa was doing. We didn't have much by worldly standards. Of course, we did have a big wood pile, but most of what was left was still now in logs, and I'd have to saw and split before we could use it. We also had meat and flour, so we could spare that. But I knew we didn't have any money, so why was Pa buying shoes and candy? Really, why was he doing any of this? Widow Jensen had closer neighbors than us. It shouldn't have been our concern. We came in from the blind side of the Jensen house and unloaded the wood as quietly as possible. Then we took the meat and flour and shoes to the door. We knocked, the door opened a crack, and a tiny, timid voice said, "Who is it?" "Lucas Miles, ma'am, and my son Matt. Could we come in for a bit?" Widow Jensen opened the door and let us in. She had a blanket wrapped around her shoulders, and the children were wrapped in another, sitting in front of the fireplace, by a very small fire that hardly gave off any heat at all. Widow Jensen fumbled with a match and finally lit the lamp. "We brought you a few things, ma'am," Pa said, and set down the sack of flour. I put the meat on the table. Then Pa handed her the sack with the head of shoes in it. She opened it hesitantly and took the shoes out one pair at a time. There was a pair for her and one for each of her children. Sturdy shoes, the best shoes, shoes that will last. I watched her carefully. She bit her lower lip to keep it from trembling, and then tears filled her eyes and started running down her cheeks. She looked up at Pa. She wanted to say something, but it just wouldn't come out. "You brought a load of wood, ma'am, too," Pa said. He turned to me and said, "Matt, we're bringing enough wood to last a while. Let's get that fire up to size and heat this place up." I wasn't the same person when I went back after bringing the wood. I had a big lump in my throat, and as much as I hate to admit it, there were tears in my eyes also. In my mind, I kept seeing those 3 kids huddled around the fireplace, and their mother standing there with tears running down her cheeks, with so much gratitude in her heart that she couldn't speak. My heart swelled up within me, and a joy that I'd never known before filled my soul. I had given at Christmas many times before, but never would have made such a difference. I could see we were literally saving the lives of these people. I soon had the fire blazing and everyone's spirits were soaring. The kids started giggling when Pa handed them each a piece of candy, and the Widow Jensen looked on with a smile that probably hadn't crossed her face in a long time. She finally turned to us. "God bless you," she said. "I know the Lord has sent you. The children and I have been praying that he would send us an angel to spare us." In spite of the lump, in spite of myself, the lump returned to my throat and the tears rolled up in my eyes. I never thought Pa in those exact terms before. But after Widow Jensen had mentioned it, I could see that it was probably true. I was sure that a better man than Pa never walked on the earth. I started remembering all the times he had gone out of his way for Mondi and many others. The list seemed endless as I thought of it. Pa insisted that everyone try on the shoes before we left. I was amazed that they all fit and wondered how he had known the sizes to get. Then I guessed that if he was on an errand for the Lord would make sure he got the right sizes. Tears were running down the Widow Jensen's face. Again, the man stood up to leave. Pa took each of the kids in his big arms and gave them a hug. They clung to him and didn't want us to go. I could see they missed their Pa, and I was glad I still had mine. At the door, Pa turned to the widow Jensen and said, "The missus wanted me to invite you and the children over for Christmas tomorrow. The turkey will be more than the three of us can eat, and the man can take us if he has to eat turkey for too many meals. We'll need not buy to get you a bottle of that. So it'll be nice to have some little ones around again. Matt here hasn't been little for quite a while. I was youngest. My two brothers and two sisters had all married and had moved away." Widow Jensen nodded and said, "Thank you, Brother Miles. I don't have to say, may the Lord bless you, for I know for certain that he will." Out on the sled, I felt a warmth that came deep within, and I didn't even notice the cold. When we had gone away, Pa turned to me and said, "Matt, I want you to know something. Your Ma and me have been tucking money away here and there all year so we could buy that rifle for you, but we didn't have quite enough. Then yesterday, Matt owed us a little money from years back, came by to make things square. Your Ma and I were really excited. Now we can get you that rifle." And I started at the town this morning to do just that. But on the way, I saw a little Jakey out there in the wood pile, feet wrapped in the gunny sacks, and I knew what I had to do. "Son, I spent money for your shoes and a little candy for those children. I hope that you understand." I understood, and my eyes became wet with tears again. I understood very well, and I was so glad I had done it. Now the rifle seemed very low on my list of priorities. I had given me a lot more. He had given me the look on little Jensen's face and the radiant smiles of her children. For the rest of my life, whenever I sensed or split a block of wood, I remembered, and the memory brought back the joy I felt riding home beside Pa that night. Pa had given me much more than a rifle that night. He had given me the best gift of my life.
A story of giving. You know, so oftentimes we get caught up in thinking that Christmas is all about the gifts. But it's not about the gifts. It's about the gift. The gift of God's love through Jesus Christ. So we're very, very thankful for that gift. Katie's got a couple of more songs. Oh no, sorry. Now we're going to do a little Town of Bethlehem.
Oh,
Makia and Rachel have done a duet that they're going to sing for us. And I don't know what song it is, but these two have been blessing me. When we first came to the church to pastor, these two were just little bitty girls. And every time they would open up their mouth to sing, I would get so emotional. And then they would sit down and I would stand up before you guys and I'd be wiping their tears. And they've always been blessing me. I know you're going to be blessing me.
Thank you. Thank you.
I wonder, you know, on that first Christmas morning when Jesus Christ was born, we gathered around. Yet very few knew. So many people gathered around. Yet very few knew that God had entered the world through the person of Jesus Christ. That little baby in a stable, lying in a manger, would be the Savior of the world. Throughout the course of December, we've been preaching messages from the Scripture, but wrapped around popular Christmas songs. Away in a manger. O come, all you faithful. What child is this? I'm glad today to gather together here with you to have sung the songs that we've sang, to play the songs that we've played, to listen to a wonderful Christmas story. It's all about the gift. And to just gather together with you, our church family, and celebrate Christmas, the birth of Jesus Christ. Our world today knows little of true Christianity. Our world today knows little of what we celebrate and why. We can see that starting very early, November even, marking down prices in department stores, luring people in to buy more and more and more and more. Can I tell you, Christmas isn't about the gifts. It is about the gift of Jesus Christ. Make no mistake, we celebrate Christmas. And we buy the gifts and we have the tree and we do the dinners, we do the gift exchanges, and it's all wonderful, it's all great, it's family time, it's time that memories are made. But we know the reason why we celebrate. And that reason is Jesus Christ. And I believe, as that song says, away in a manger, I believe that we've gotten away from the manger. I believe we've gotten away from the true meaning of Christmas and what it can do to a person's heart to come to realize that no matter who you are, where you live, how much money you make, or how many sins you've committed, God's love entered into this world. God's hope entered into this world. God's salvation entered into this world. Instead of getting away from the manger, I hope today that just the same as that angel came down and revealed himself to those shepherds and declared to the shepherds what had taken place that night in Bethlehem. For unto you, the angel said, is born this day in the city of David a Savior, which is Christ the Lord. It amazes me that that first message, the first gospel message that was preached from the angel Gabriel went to shepherds, because shepherds were called to guard the sheep. There were many who would have taken Jesus' life. Herod wanted him dead. So God, in all of his wisdom, sent the message to the ones who were put on this earth to protect the sheep, God's own lamb. He delivered that message to the shepherds. And that angel gave them, shepherds, an open invitation to come and see that which the Lord has revealed to them. Because he said, this shall be a sign unto you. You shall find that babe wrapped in swaddling clothes, lying in a manger. An open invitation for them to come and see. And after the angel had spoken that message, all of heaven could not contain itself. For a multitude of heavenly hosts began praising God. And all of them, and all of the praising declaration was over. And once again, those shepherds were left standing there out in the fields, keeping watch over their flock by night. They weren't the same in that moment as they were just moments before. And you know what? When you are presented with the gospel of Jesus Christ, you too are no longer the same as you were just moments before. Whatever it is that we do with the gospel has an everlasting effect on who we are. Whether we receive it and are blessed for it, whether we reject it, we will never again be the same. Once that gospel, once that news that Jesus Christ has entered into this world, it will change you. It will change every person. You'll no longer be the same. And these shepherds, what did they know of what was happening? They woke up one day, they went to work, they're standing out in the fields, they're taking care of the sheep, and boom, here comes heaven to tell them, the Messiah has been born. The King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. They were no longer the same. And they were intrigued, really. Wouldn't you be? I would be. I mean, if an angel came to 1015 Franklin Street tonight and said, I've got a message from heaven for you. This has happened. I might be intrigued. I might want to know of it. I might want to go see for myself. And so these shepherds, they said, let us go now even into Bethlehem and see this thing which has come to pass. They were away from the manger. But they came to the manger. And they peered in and they saw Jesus Christ, God's own Son. The hope of all who seek Him. Jesus Christ, born to us. We've gotten so far away from the manger that I believe that in our hearts and in our minds, we too need to be like those shepherds. We need to start seeking that manger again. We need to put Christ back into Christmas. We need to put Christ back into our hearts. We need to put Christ back into our homes. I know tomorrow's going to come, and I know your families are going to be gathered around. Will it all be about the presents? Will it all be about the dinners? Will it all be about the same thing? Will you dare to peer into the manger and allow Christ to be the center of your celebrations this year? There are some who will say, well, I would love to, but I don't know if I'm going to be able to pull that off. You see, my family doesn't understand. And I know there's some that will say, yes, Pastor, we'll do that. I promise for those of you who will dare to do that, you're going to find a fuller Christmas than you have celebrated in a long time. Yeah, they got away from the manger, but... Then there was another message that went out to not just the shepherds, but went out to everyone, went out to you, went out to me. Oh, come, all ye faithful, the faithful, the joyful, and the triumphant. I'm glad today for your faithfulness. I'm glad today for your faith that seeks the face of Jesus Christ. I'm glad today for your faithfulness to God. I'm glad today for your faithfulness to your church. I'm glad today for your faithfulness to your families. I'm glad today for your faithfulness because, you see, there's an invitation to the faithful as well. Oh, come all ye faithful, the joyful. You say, preacher, I'm not all that joyful this year. Christmas just doesn't seem like Christmas. You want to know what's happened? You've mistaken happiness for joy. Happiness can come and happiness can go, but joy, you all see? Joy is one of those gifts that's given to every born-again child of God. And it's inside the heart of you. So even if there's sadness in our world, sadness in your world, you can still have joy. Come all ye faithful, the joyful, and the triumphant. It hasn't been easy, has it? Somebody once told me that when you receive Jesus Christ to be your Lord and your Savior, all your problems go away. All your heartaches vanish. You're never going to lose any more sleep. You're never going to have another headache. Can I tell you something? Somebody lied to me. I found it's not that way at all. I still have troubles. I still have trials. I still have heartaches. I still have headaches. I still have hard times. But I've got something now that I didn't have then. And that's Jesus Christ. And because Jesus Christ is the overcomer, through Him I can be an overcomer. Through Him I am an overcomer. And if you're in Christ, and Christ is in you, and you've been washed in the blood, and you've been filled with the Spirit, hear me today. It doesn't matter what you've done. It doesn't matter what your circumstance or situation might be. You are triumphant because you are in Jesus Christ. Had it not been for Jesus Christ entering into this world through the virgin womb, of Mary, we would never have known the joy of salvation. We ask ourselves, what child is this who lays to rest on Mary's lap and sleeping? What child is this? This is Christ the King, whom shepherds guard and angels sing. Amen. This child is the hope of every born-again child of God. This child is the joy that dwells inside every Christian's heart. This child is God's salvation that has been given to men. For the Bible says, God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son, that whosoever would believe in Him should not perish but have everlasting life. This child, this is Christ the King. This is who we celebrate. This is what the season is all about. Away in a manger. O come all you faithful. What child is this? These are the messages that we've been preaching and we've been teaching to you all throughout the course of December. And I've got a few verses of scripture. This is found in Titus, chapter number 2. Now, many of you might think, well, where is there a Christmas message found in the book of Titus? Pastor Thad, shouldn't you be in Matthew chapter 1 and 2? Shouldn't you be in Luke chapter 2? Maybe even in the book of John chapter 1, but Titus? What do we see about Christmas in Titus? Ha! Say amen when you're there.
Amen.
Titus chapter 2, verse number 11 says, "For the grace of God that bringeth salvation hath appeared unto all men." Do you see the Christmas message in those very first words? The grace of God. We are saved by grace through faith, and that not of yourself. It is the gift of God, not of works, lest any man should boast. But who can tell me today, what is God's grace? Someone will say, it's His unmerited favor. And you're right about that. We don't earn God's grace. It's given to us freely. So rather than asking you, what is God's grace, can I ask you, who is God's grace? Maybe you've never been confronted with that question before. Jesus Christ is the grace of God. When we sing Amazing Grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me, we could really be singing Amazing Christ, how sweet the sound who saved a wretch like me, because Jesus Christ is God's grace. So when we know that and we understand that, we can take a look at Titus chapter 2, verse 11, and say, for a certainty, this is a Christmas message. For the grace of God that bringeth salvation. That's the reason Jesus came. It wasn't to boost our self-esteem, although He does that. It wasn't for any other thing other than to bring salvation into this world. You see, because of sin, there was a separation between God and man. And God in His love for that which He had created was not willing to allow there to be a separation. Something had to happen to mend that broken relationship, and that something was Jesus Christ. When Christ came into this world, He was the perfect, holy, righteous Lamb of God who knew no sin. But as He grew, He took on our sin and paid the price so that you and I might have right to the tree of life. He died on the cross. He did not stay in a manger. We're celebrating Him being in a manger, but He didn't stay in a manger. He grew. And they nailed Him to a cross. And they took Him down, but on the third and appointed day, by the power of the Holy Ghost of God, He resurrected to give us hope of eternal life and to save us and to deliver us from our sins. The angel told Mary, "You shall bring forth a son. You shall call His name Emmanuel. He shall save His people from their sins." That's why He came. God's grace. "For the grace of God that bringeth salvation hath appeared unto all men." You've heard the gospel. You know the story of Jesus Christ. What will we do with the gospel? What decision will we make with it? What will you do with the truth about Jesus Christ? Teaching us that denying ungodliness and worldly lusts, we should live soberly, righteously, and godly in this present world, looking for that blessed hope. You see, because Jesus Christ entered into this world, we now have hope. You look out the windows today of the church, you look out the windows today of your house, look through the window of your television, or look through the window of your local newspaper, and all you see is one turmoil after another, one fight after another, one war after another. And if you pay close attention to all of that, it can leave you with a feeling of despair and like there is no hope any longer. But can I tell you something? As long as Jesus Christ is alive, there's always hope. And let me tell you something. Jesus Christ is eternal. In Jesus Christ, there is hope. You say, Pastor Thad, do you really have hope? I can say, yeah, I've really got hope. I've got hope that people can be redeemed. I've got hope that people can be saved. I got hope that families can be blessed. I got hope that our nation can be a great nation again. I've got hope that one day when all this is over, that Jesus Christ is coming back to get his church and to take us to a real place that was made with real hands, prepared in heaven for you and for me. There's hope, friend. There's hope. There's hope. And the glorious appearing of the great God, our Savior, Jesus Christ, who gave himself for us that he might redeem us from all iniquity and purify unto himself a peculiar people, zealous of good works. These things speak and exhort and rebuke with all authority. Let no man despise thee. Friend, today we have preached away in a manger, and showed you that we've gotten away from the manger. We have preached, O come, all ye faithful, ye joyful, and ye triumphant. And we've preached, what child is this? As we close, I want you to picture all of the noise and the confusion and everything that was taking place in Bethlehem that night. Bethlehem, a little town. Bethlehem, a small community. Who overnight just exploded with people. Everyone who had a family history that started in Bethlehem had to come back to Bethlehem to be registered and to be taxed. There was no sleeping, there was no resting. People continued to come and continued to come and continued to come. And the little town began bulging, and it seems, because it couldn't hold any more people. How do you know that? Because when Mary and Joseph came there, they were told, I'm sorry, there's nowhere else to put anybody. I don't have no room for you. You know it had to be loud. You know it had to be busy. You know it had to be confusing. You know there had to be arguing. You know there had to be bickering. There were so many distractions. And it was so loud, and it was so chaotic. Kind of reminds us of our world today a little bit, doesn't it? But listen, inside that little stable, it was silent. It was quiet. It was peaceful. Outside that little stable, it was loud, it was chaotic, but inside that little stable, it was silent. You know, they just did Silent Night on the bells. It's amazing that that song's done, because it's going to help give you a vision of what it is that's on my heart right now. That night outside was chaotic and loud, but inside it was silent. Can I tell you something? It might be loud and chaotic out there, but on the inside, it can be silent. It can be peaceful. Because Jesus Christ entered into this world, because you know of it, because you received it, because he's yours and you're his. Whatever's happening out there that's loud and in your ears and in your mind and is causing you inside, it was a silent night. It was a holy night. It was holy. Maybe the holiest of all holy nights that ever happened happened that night because Jesus Christ was born. And I'm so thankful that holiness came into this world, because the Bible says holiness without which no man shall see God. How many of you want to see God one day? How many of you want to see the face of God who created you and saved you? You can do it. You can, friend. You can. You can. Because Jesus Christ came into this world. God's salvation. God's holiness. We are unholy, but He's holy. And through Him, we can achieve holiness and stand before a righteous God without blame. That's why we celebrate Christmas. Listen, at home, we have the lights. We have the presents. We have the tree. And we're going to celebrate Christmas, and we're going to open up our gifts. But we know that we know that we know in our hearts the whole reason is for Jesus Christ. So it's my hope and it's my prayer for you this year that you will be blessed. Amen. And that your lives and your homes will be full of the joy and peace and the hope that comes through Jesus Christ. So let us stand for one last song. We're going to ask the girls to come and lead us. There's things that some of them are going through that are trying. But we know, Lord, that because of you we have joy. Because of you we have peace. So I just pray, Lord, that you would restore their joy. Lord, that you would allow them to celebrate this wonderful, wonderful day. And to keep our eyes focused upon you. Father, I love these people, each and every one, and I know that you do too. So I'm going to ask you once again, Lord, to please keep them all safe from harm's way and bring us back at our next appointed time. And once again, we can worship you in spirit and in truth. All honor, glory, worship, and praise we give unto thee. It's in Jesus' name that we pray.